Okay, can we jump to the next slide, Jane? Thank you. Okay, so we've had lots of sort of special things going on for the last, quite a few weeks, haven't we? Baptismal, visiting preacher last Sunday. If you weren't here last Sunday, you missed an extraordinary sermon that was a tremendous challenge. Yeah. They did miss. Yeah, it was really amazing. Yeah, we're going to we're organising getting our sermons onto a YouTube channel that people can go onto, a subscribed one, a closed one, and get people access to it so that we can go on and we can listen if we do miss a sermon, particularly one like last Sunday. That was one of Mary's lecturers from her university course who came and shared with us. So we're coming back this morning, rightly, to our theme for the year, which is in Acts 2, chapter 4, Acts 2, verses 42 to 47. I want to read them. Turn with me. Okay, so Acts 2:42, reading from verse 42, we read as follows. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe, and many wonders and miraculous signs were done by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common, selling their possessions and goods. They gave to anyone who, as he had need. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Andrew and I looked at these verses and really felt we should take them as our sort of theme for the year and our real focus for the year. One of the things we discovered about them is that in these verses, all of the five key purposes of God for his church are addressed and dealt with, okay? Those five purposes, of course, are on the board over there. Magnify, mission, membership, maturity, and ministry. So I could just read them off there quickly. So I want this morning to deal with the first of those, which says magnify up there. Because we find the church right here, right at the very beginning, doing just that, don't we? Verse 47 says, or picking up in verse 46 to make it sense, they broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. So right from the absolute beginning point of the church, one of the characteristics that defined them was that they praised God. Let's take the word, therefore, this morning as our overall heading, the word worship. Worship. God has programmed a desire to worship into every human life. It is one of our defining characteristics as human beings. It's in us. It's been password protected. We can't take it out of us. It's there. When anthropologists visit and look at societies and discover, another remote society and this community and that community and so on, in every single community they look at, they find that people worship. It's intrinsic to who we are. When Moses went to Pharaoh and said to Pharaoh, God says, let my people go. What was the reason God said through Moses? It was so that they may worship me. Because that's why God chose them as his people. When the wise men set out on a journey of over 1,000 miles, following some stars to go and see a child who was born, what did they say they'd come to do when they finally found that baby? They said, "We've come to worship him." You know, not Jews, not Christians, people from a completely different culture. Wise men, intrinsic within being a wise man, is still the desire, the drive, the need to worship. That is how God has made us. You know, like we have an intrinsic desire to breathe, to eat, we have an intrinsic desire and need to worship. And of course, the reality is that every one of us here, every human being does worship. We all worship. Even men worship. Up on the screen is going to come a picture just now of men worshiping. Their hands are in the air. They're singing. Simon's there somewhere. Oh, I think he might be this. No, he's just over there, aren't you, Simon? What are they doing as they're singing and shouting and their hands are in the air? They are worshiping. They are giving worth to the players, to the team they support. They're saying, "Hey, you know, what they're saying, we love you." Okay, they often sing that out as well, actually, when you listen to them. They are worshiping. It's intrinsic within us. It's just a question, actually, in reality, of who we worship, isn't it? Why has God made every human being with the intrinsic need to worship? You know, if those guys who we just saw in that picture, if they didn't worship West Ham, they'd worship something else in their lives. Why do we have this desire to worship within us? Let's turn to John chapter 4, which is the passage we're going to focus on this morning, particularly, and learn about worship. John chapter 4, I'm going to read from verse 1. Quite a few verses, but we need to get the story here. Okay, John 4, verse 1, we read, "The Pharisees heard that Jesus was gaining and baptizing more disciples than John, although in fact it was Jesus. It was not Jesus who baptized, but his disciples. When the Lord learned of this, he left Judea and went back once more to Galilee. Now he had to go through Samaria, so he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near the plot of ground Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about the sixth hour. And when a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, 'Will you give me a drink?' His disciples had gone into the town to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, 'You are a Jew and I am a Samaritan woman. How can you ask me for a drink?' For Jews do not associate with Samaritans. And Jesus answered her, 'If you knew the gift of God and who it is that asks you for a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water.' 'Sir,' the woman said, 'you have nothing to draw with and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his flocks and herds?' And Jesus answered, 'Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give him will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give him will become in him a spring of water, welling up to eternal life.' And the woman said to him, 'Sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming here to draw water.' He told her, 'Go, call your husband and come back.' I have no husband, she replied. Jesus said to her, you are right when you say you have no husband. The fact is you have had five husbands and the man you now have is not your husband. What you have just said is quite true. Sir, the woman said, I can see that you are a prophet. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem. Jesus declared, believe me, woman, the time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. Yet a time is coming and has come when the true worshippers will worship the Father in spirit and truth, for they are the kind of worshippers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshippers must worship him in spirit and in truth. So to answer the question, why has God made us like this? The answer there is there, isn't it? At the end of verse 23, it says, for they are the kind of worshippers the Father seeks. God is seeking people who will worship him. That's what he's doing. It doesn't even say, just say, the Father desires people to worship who will worship him. It says the Father seeks people who will worship him. God's great desire and his actions right through the Bible, therefore, you know, from Abraham through the story of Moses and on, has been seeking people who will worship him. Who will worship him? What is worship? We don't have a sort of a definition of worship in the Bible, so let me give you a couple that I find helpful. Up will come one in just a moment on the screen. It will say this in a moment, I think. How are we doing? Okay, it should be saying this. Worship is the believer's response with all that he is, mind, emotions, will, and body, to all that God is and says and does. Worship is the believer's response with all that we have to all that God is and says and does. Or Rick Warren says, every time we express our love to God, we are worshiping him. The greatest purpose of our lives is to worship God, therefore. The highest privilege we have as human beings, made in the image of God, is to worship him. Our biggest responsibility, therefore, is to worship him. Our first priority is to worship him. Intrinsically, we are made as worshippers. But the challenge, therefore, is who are we worshipping? What are we worshipping? Have we worshipped God this past week? The story that we are looking at here in John 4 is the story of the Samaritan woman who came to Jesus and tried to debate with her, oh, how should we do our worship? Because we do it like this as Samaritans and you do it like that as Jews. And who's right? Is your place right or our place right? What's the best time we should do it? And Jesus replied to her and said, ha ha, worship is no longer about where you do it. That is now irrelevant. Worship is about this, Jesus said to her. And Jesus gave her two truths, and we're going to take those truths and add to them three more truths from Scripture about worship that pleases God. If our worship is to please God, what's it to be like? Okay, verse 24. God is spirit, it says, and his worshippers must worship him in spirit and in truth. Okay, you're going to take the second one first. We must worship him in truth. Some people say God's a great big kind person who's going to take care of everyone in the end of the day, and it'll all be all right, don't you worry. We'll all live happily ever after together. That is not truth. That is not, if that's the image of God that we have and we worship that image, that is not in truth. Others, of course, say, oh, God is so distant. I can't imagine that God would be particularly interested in me and want to show me love and concern. And that is another false, untruthful image of God. When we worship God, we are to worship him in truth. We're not to construct our own image of him and worship that. Worshiping him in truth, based on scripture, based on what the Bible says. So the more we use the Bible in our worship, the better. If we use the Bible in our worship, we can't go wrong. We are worshiping in truth because we are expressing the realities about who God is like from scripture itself. That's why it's a great thing to use the Bible. Why so many worship songs are taken from words from scripture and the Psalms and so on. Because we are to worship in truth. If we are to worship God as he wants to be worshipped. And secondly, yes, that verse says God is spirit and his worshippers must worship him in spirit and in truth. We must worship him in spirit. What is it that distinguishes us from the rest of creation? God has given us a spirit as human beings, or a soul as it's sometimes expressed in scripture. This is how God has made us. God is spirit, and we as his creation each have a spirit within us, a center to us, an eternal. The eternal me is my spirit. It is not my body. What lasts for every one of us is our spirit. Billy Graham is now free of his body, but his spirit is in that place he so desired. He is with his Maker and his Savior. Our spirit, and we are to worship God from within. Our worship of him must come from within. It must. That worshipping from within, therefore, of course, speaks of sincerity, doesn't it? And genuineness. Our worship is not to be an outward thing that is a matter of show. But it's to come from within. As God said to Samuel one day, when Samuel was looking at the sons of Jesse to work out who was the best to be king, God said, hey, I'm not looking at who's the big strong fighter. I'm looking at their hearts to see what's within. And that's how God looks at us as we worship him. He is looking at our hearts. He's looking within. I'm just going to turn to Matthew 15 and verse 8, and Jesus does some more teaching here that sort of develops this point. Matthew 15 verse 8. We read as follows. Jesus quotes from Isaiah, and he says, these people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are but rules taught by men. These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Okay, Jesus warns against vain worship. Worship which is just a matter of the lips. Worship which will achieve nothing because it's not backed by the reality from within. We can worship God imperfectly, but we cannot worship him insincerely. Insincerity nullifies worship. It is not worship if we are not sincere in our worship of him. It must be worship from within, worship from the depths of our spirit, an expression of what's really going on in our lives. We worship him in spirit and in truth. Thirdly, worship that's acceptable to God must be worship that involves our minds, our thoughts. Matthew 22 and verse 37. Verse we know well, love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. Loving God, as Rick Warren said, when we express our love for God, that is an act of worship. It has to be with our mind. It has to engage our thinking. Our thoughts need to be involved. We need to think about what we're doing. We need to be expressing, you know, from our thoughts to God what is within us. Matthew 6, verse 5. Jesus said as follows, when you pray, do not be like the hypocrites, for they love to pray standing in the synagogues and on the street corners to be seen by men. I tell you the truth, they have received their reward in full. But when you pray, go into a room, close the door and pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. Do not be like them. For your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Beware in worship of just vain repetition, saying things for show, words that don't mean anything to us personally, babbling, as Jesus says in those verses. That's how the Pharisees worshipped. This was an expression of their hypocrisy. On the outside, they were one thing. Inside, they were something else. Beware as we worship just of using lots of religious words that we've heard and strung together and not really grasping what they mean and understanding them. We must make sense in our worship to God. It must make sense to each other and to him when we worship, because we are to worship with our thoughts. Fourthly, worship which is acceptable to God is costly to the person who worships. In the Old Testament, when they went to worship in the temple, they took with them a sacrifice. They took with them indeed the firstborn. Therefore, if they only had one lamb at that point, they took the only lamb they had and they sacrificed it as part of their worship to God. One day God said to Abraham, Abraham, I want you to go and sacrifice your son to me, your only son. And so Abraham the next day called his servants together and he said to his servants, did he say to them, we're going to sacrifice Isaac? No, he didn't. He said to them, we are going to worship. That's what he said to his servants. To Abraham, the act of sacrificing his own son was an act of worship. David said, I will not sacrifice to the Lord any burnt offering that has cost me nothing. Sacrificing, offerings, worship are costly. They are costly. Therefore, praise alone to God is incomplete worship, because worship must involve surrender. It must involve sacrifice. It must involve giving up. It must involve yielding ourselves before God. Hence, Paul wrote, offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, for that is your acceptable spiritual worship. How does worship cost us something in our lives? When we get up or go out on a cold night and visit someone, that's an act of worship. When we switch off the TV that we wanted to watch and we open God's Word and we read and begin to commune with God there, that's an act of worship. True worship costs. And lastly, true worship continues. Worship isn't just something we do here. From the rising of the sun to the going down of the same, the Lord's name is to be praised. From the beginning of the moment we're awake till the moment we fall asleep, all that time in between, the Lord's name is to be praised. In the Bible, people praise God at work, at home, in a bed, lying down, standing up, in jail, on a battlefront. All those places and more, we can find people worshipping God. Turn with me to Psalm 34. Pretty well in the middle of the Bible. Psalm 34, verse 1, David says, I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. There we have it. Our prayer, worship isn't an act that we do in the end of the day. We may do acts as part of worship, but that is not the total of worship. That doesn't sum up worship. Singing songs here is not the totality of worship. The totality of worship is expressed by David. I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. Worship is a way of life. It's how we live tomorrow and Tuesday and Wednesday and Thursday and Friday and Saturday, and whether we live each day as an act of worship. Whether we are extolling the Lord each day, whether his praise is continually on our lips, whether we are sacrificing to him, whether we are, our hearts and minds and our spirits are engaged with him. Because he is our God and we are his child. He is our Father and we are with him. And we are walking with him and our life is an act of worship with him. Paul wrote to the Corinthians, whatever you do, do it all for the glory of God. And that's the purpose of worship, is to glorify God. So whatever you do, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, do it all for the glory of God. Yes, even our work and our study can be an act of worship if we do it for the glory of God. Bringing up our children can be an act of worship if we do it for the glory of God, as his praise is continually on our lips. In the 17th century, there was a monk called Brother Lawrence. And Brother Lawrence, he aspired to be a great monk. He wanted to be a preacher. He wanted to lead an order of monks. He felt he was going to be really good at those sort of things and to be in charge and run the services and so on. And he started off in the monastery just doing basic things of washing dishes and growing vegetables. outside the monastery to support the monks. And as time went on, he started to become quite frustrated about why he wasn't sort of being given more responsibility in the monastery, in the community. And then God began to deal with him. And Brother Lawrence ended up spending 35 years washing dishes and growing vegetables. And he wrote an extraordinary little booklet, really, that was something so important to me when I read it in my Christian life. It was called Practicing the Presence of God. And God taught him how he was with him as he washed the dishes, and how he could commune with him as he washed the dishes, and how he could commune with him as he tended the vegetable garden. And that God didn't commune any more with the guy who was running the services and running the monastery than he did with him while he washed the dishes. And how in the reality of everyday life he could practice the presence of God. Because God is always with us. God's ear, is the scripture tells us, is always attentive towards us. So if we are not experiencing his presence and enjoying his presence, that's on our side, not his. A Muslim may pray 5 times a day. A Christian can pray every moment of the day, continually communing with God, doing all for the glory of God, living our lives as an act of worship to our God, a God who has made us that we might worship, a God who seeks us to worship him in spirit, in truth, with our minds, in a costly way, and worship him continually. One of the great Christian songs about worship, and we're going to hear it in a moment, is a song written by a guy called Matt Redman. We already sang one of Matt Redman's songs this morning. Matt Redman's a worship leader in this country, and he tells how his pastor taught his church the real meaning of worship. To show that worship is more than music, he banned all singing in their services for a period of time, while they learn to worship in other ways. Be an interesting challenge, that one, wouldn't it? Okay. By the end of the time, when they hadn't sung at all, Matt Redmond wrote the words of a song called The Heart of Worship. And we're going to listen to that song together now. Let's appreciate these words. I think the words come from the screen as we listen to the song too. simple.